Welcome back to the new U.S. Lacrosse headquarters in Sparks, Maryland. Plenty of apparel on sale this weekend for fans of all ages. And welcome back to the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic presented by U.S. Lacrosse. Travis Eldridge now with you once again, joined by Melissa Coyne, the Director of Game Operations here for U.S. Lacrosse. And Melissa, we're getting ready for U.S., their second game here of the day, but this time taking on a fellow national team in England. This is a rematch of a game that happened over across the pond earlier this summer, one that was dominated by the U.S., but we're going to see a very different roster than the one that we just saw against North Carolina as they try to emulate what it's going to be like in the World Cup this summer.
Head coach Ricky Freed splitting his roster, half playing against North Carolina, the other half will play here against England. A couple crossovers for numbers' sake. But yeah, I would expect, even though you're seeing a completely different roster, much of the same pace of play. They play within the same system, so I anticipate you'll see much of the same.
Alex Austin and Michelle Tumelo, the two players that will carry over from the game against North Carolina, you saw just about a half an hour, 45 minutes ago. As for England, for college lacrosse fans, a couple of notable names, most importantly, Maryland's Megan Whittle. What will she bring to this English squad?
Well, she brings a resume that has a total of, I think, three losses in her career from high school through college. So she's a perennial champion. She's a national champion. So I think that brings an attitude and a confidence to Team England that they really needed, and an athleticism they haven't really seen much of before.
Well, she scored against the U.S. earlier this summer against Team USA in its scrimmages across the pond. We'll see if she can do so again here this afternoon as we're getting ready for England and the U.S. You'll see that on the other side here on LAC Sports Network.
Why do we do what we do?
Well, we believe that participation in lacrosse positively influences lives.
We believe lacrosse should be open to all kids that want to play.
We believe in a future that offers everyone the opportunity to participate.
U.S. Lacrosse is a nonprofit organization that provides resources to fuel the sport's growth and development.
Support our efforts at uslacrosse.org.
Lacrosse Now is your lacrosse fix every night. Every night at 9 p.m. Eastern Time, Lacrosse Now reports on the most important stories in the sport. Lacrosse Now delivers the highlights, the scores, and the analysis from your favorite teams. And the best part? It's 7 nights a week. See the show the lacrosse fans can't live without. Lacrosse Now on LSN. It's all LACCESS.
You don't want to miss the newest show to hit the LAC Sports Network programming lineup, LAC's Fit. A show dedicated to providing smart exercise and training guides, tips, information, and demonstrations for the lacrosse athlete. We take you behind the scenes with RPM Lacrosse founder and director Malcolm Chase to show you how to train with workouts specifically designed for lacrosse players. LAC Fit, only on LAC Sports Network. It's all LACCESS.
Only on LAC Sports Network. College Digest is your weekly destination for everything related to the men's and women's college game this offseason. Be sure to tune in every week as we check in with coaches, players, and the experts to bring you the latest news and headlines from across the college lacrosse landscape. LSN College Digest, every Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Eastern on LAC Sports Network. It's all LACCESS.
Today's USA versus England game is presented by Under Armour. Under Armour, the official partner and equipment supplier of Team USA.
Alex Mercer.
Welcome back here to the U.S. Lacrosse headquarters in Sparks, Maryland. Game 3 of 4 here today. This one between the national team of the United States against the national team of England. And we're getting set for the draw. Travis Eldridge back with Melissa Coyne, the Director of Game Administration for U.S. Lacrosse. Happy to be alongside for Game 3 of 4 here today. The U.S. coming off a win over North Carolina in Game 2. Right back at you about 40 minutes between those two games, beating North Carolina 20-7 in Game 3. Meanwhile, or in Game 2, the first game of the day, England losing to Australia in a heartbreaker, 12-11. And we are off here at the U.S. Lacrosse headquarters, draw 1 by England. And an opportunity to scoop it up. Heavy pressure there by the United States. And a whistle.
Nice draw possession there by England. That's going to be key for them. If they have any chance in this contest, they're going to have to possess the ball.
Sloane Serpy applying tight pressure along the sideline there. But England keeps possession. And clears it way over the other side. It's Armstrong. Katie Armstrong collects, brings it over the midfield stripe. And England looks to try to get some type of settled offense here to start the game.
Yeah, that's the key to the U.S. defense. They're not going to allow for a lot of settled offense. They want to create unsettled situations. They'll put pressure way out on the ball. They will essentially wear down everyone they play.
A shot and a score. Lori Merrifield puts on the first goal of the game. England is on the board first here. It's 1-0.
Merrifield, a product of the University of Maryland, a great collegiate player in her time. Nice face dodge there and a good finish.
No shortage of Terps on the field throughout today.
England goal, number 19,
former ACC most valuable player back when Maryland was in the Atlantic Coast Conference. That has obviously changed over the last several years, now in the Big Ten. But she puts England up 1-0 early against the U.S. This is a very different U.S. roster, as we mentioned in the open. Coach Ricky Fried wanting to simulate what they're going to face in the World Cup this summer. So keeping the rosters to 18 so they can get the substitution patterns and everything very similar to what they'll do this summer.
Right. And as I said, you know, even though you have different personnel in the field, you're going to see the same system. You know, it looks like the weather has held off a little bit here, not raining as steadily as it was before. So that's an improvement.
Certainly is. As we have a stoppage as U.S. looks to set up a free position here. Triggered in by Alyssa Murray. Rabs feeds out to the top of the key. This is Marie McCool from North Carolina, current Tar Heel. Didn't play against her current team. Maybe a sigh of relief for her. I don't know if she was probably looking forward to an opportunity to play against the Tar Heels.
Yeah, none of the current or former Tar Heels played in that first game there. So, you know, they're as a group getting back on the field together. Some of them played together for a long time. Laura Zimmerman, Jen Russell, very familiar with each other. So a good contingent of Terps and Tar Heels on this squad.
A shot in front and a save there by England. It was Alyssa Leonard who had a good opportunity for the U.S., but the save, and England stays up 1-0.
Yeah, I'm not sure which goalkeeper this is in the goal here for England. She's wearing a different jersey number than
different
we've
numbers.
Seen, but we'll try to figure out who that is.
As England brings it over the midfield stripe. And touches it in as there's a lot of pressure, as you will see from this U.S. defense. Draws a whistle, though. England keeps possession. Shot in the front and another score. Never mind, we have a whistle.
Yep, we're gonna have a no goal there and a charge on the England player. That looks like number 8, Cookie Carr for the U.S. stood her ground pretty well there.
And so the goal is waved off.
Right, so as you see that follow through there from 20, she's lucky she didn't get carded there, but I'm not sure that the charge was the right call, but certainly right to make a call there.
Camilla Hayes, the player there for England.
Ricky Fried looking for clarification there as well. What he wants is a card on that player for a dangerous follow-through, not necessarily a charge play.
And cards even more important in the international game because of the full time, correct?
Correct. I mean, that was a clear follow-through into the head of another player. Right of the official blow the whistle, just made the wrong call there.
And so either way, the U.S. gains possession. Brings it over the midfield stripe. Still looking for The first goal of this game, 2 for them, game 3 of 4 here at the U.S. Fall Classic in Sparks, Maryland, as Leonard works with it. Sends it back top and around. This is McCool. Pass in front is deflected. Loose ball scooped up by England.
This is a much more athletic, much more fit England team than maybe the U.S. had seen in the past.
A great opportunity. Nobody in the net. And an easy finish for Jenny Simpson. First time representing the English national team for her, and she makes it 2-0 England early on.
Again, the U.S. with their pressure defense and pulling their goalie so far out is that risk-reward. On the reward side, they often create turnovers. On the risk side, you end up with some open cage opportunities.
Kaylee Waters came way out of the cage for that one, something we saw Liz Hogan do in the first game for the U.S. here today. That time, it does not pay off for the U.S., and England has to be gaining some confidence here early on against a U.S. team that beat them pretty well this summer, taking down England 20-2 across the pond when they played back in July. Draw control scooped up by England, but a steal by the United States on the pass.
Yeah, just a few short minutes into this game. Really like what I'm seeing from Team England. Able to move the ball up and down the field with relative ease. Can't imagine that Ricky Fried's too happy with the way that this ride is being executed. More importantly, what's happening in the offensive end and their ability to sort of capitalize, move the ball. Not quite seeing from this U.S. side what we've seen from the other. So, but we're only just a couple minutes in, so I give them some time here.
Rabel sends it over. Gets it back. And they finally kind of work it around here. Zimmerman. Back to Maggie Bill, the current North Carolina Tar Heel. Sends it back to Rabel at the top. They play pitch and catch. Rabel, shot and a save. And so England, just about 6 minutes in, still keeping the United States scoreless so far.
Two solid saves from the England goalkeeper. That's probably been one of the biggest improvements I've seen in their team is their goalkeeping play.
So Megan Whittle, we spoke about her in the open, the current Maryland Terrapin. She stopped looking for a whistle, I believe, and it's quickly stripped away by Rabel. Kelly Rabel collects and gets the possession here for the United States. Maggie Bill brings it over the midfield stripe. Maggie Bill, a current North Carolina, not only lacrosse player, but soccer player, has been playing all season, a starter for the Tar Heels soccer team. Remember, she took all of last year off, but it seems like she's fresh and ready to go for a very, very busy calendar year for her.
That's pretty unbelievable. Not too many people, players, male or female, I know, that are playing for two national championship caliber teams in a single calendar year. Think the rest that she took last year was good for her. She seems to have come back refreshed. Tremendous asset for the Carolina team.
Megan Whittle couldn't quite get that pass to go through, so the United States picks it up. And you mentioned Maggie Bill. On top of playing for two national championship caliber teams, she's also in the mix for this World Cup roster. So really an incredible accomplishment for any athlete. And Maggie Bill certainly showcasing why she is one of the premier athletes in this sport. Here she is. Hands off. There for Zimmerman. Now down to the attack. Pass in front. Couldn't be corralled by Alex Ost. And then a whistle and a turnover. It'll give it to England.
So one of the things that's been interesting to watch so far in just these first few minutes is where North Carolina played a backer defense, where that backside and the center were often open. England is playing a straight up defense, which was making that pass into the middle covered. So haven't seen the U.S. team make an adjustment on that yet, but I would expect that they will shortly.
Lucy Lynch brings it in. A tough pass originally corralled by England. Instead, it's a loose ball. It is eventually scooped up by Lynch in an offensive possession. A shot from way out, and it goes. Wow, from way downtown, it's Camilla Hayes. And she puts England up 3-0 just about 9 minutes in to this first half.
The U.S. looks a little uncertain of exactly where they want to be defensively. Not much. That's a ball that Kaylee Waters, with her experience and her level play, should have. Not often you see a goal scored from that far out. Unfortunate there for the U.S., but quite an opening few minutes for England.
Camilla Hayes played in her college career at Cal and Maryland, played in the national championship game for the Terps, also plenty part of three European championship teams for this English squad. So she has some international experience, a goal for her. And England has already over exceeded their goals total from the entire game against this U.S. squad back this summer.
It's good to see. It's good to see an England squad that's willing to make some changes and willing to make some adjustments.
2-on-1 and another shot to score. England up 4-0 early on in the United States.
England goal number 2, Olivia Hunt. Hunt scores, puts up England 4-0 with 20 minutes 2 left in the first half.
Going top shelf on Kaylee Waters in a tough back-to-back goals for her as she gave up the long goal and then one right there on the doorstep. And so 4-0, United States trails England. If you're Ricky Freed, what are you saying to your team? What are there any adjustments that you need to make here right now?
I think they could adjust pretty much everything. So I'm sure, watching Ricky there on the sideline, he seems to be pretty calm at this point. I think he just needs his team to settle down a little bit and do what they do well. No need to panic. 20
right.
Minutes left in the first half. I imagine he can't be very happy, especially offensively, with their inability to sort of run a good set here. Liz Robertshaw, who coaches, Boston University coach, who also coaches the offense here, she looks equally as unhappy with what's happening on the offensive end. So might see a timeout here if there's another goal, or they might let them try to play through this.
Marie McCool looking to get the U.S. on the board for the first time here in the third game of this U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic. Oss pass is deflected and collected by England. A chance to go here in transition. Loose ball scooped up by England. Waters way out of her cage, intercepted it, but a whistle before that.
Yep, looks like we had a foul there on Mara Schwitter.
Another shot just high, sails over the net, but backed up by England.
This will be an interesting matchup. I've seen the last couple times down here. Sloan serve matched up on Megan Whittle. Clearly they're trying to deny her the ball. It's not something that Whittle's not accustomed to seeing. She sees face guards quite often. It's not quite a face guard, but they're certainly paying close attention to her.
Here comes Hayes, and she gets another one to go. Her second goal, and it's 5-0 England.
I think you might see Coach Freed call a timeout here.
And there it is. And so the U.S. calls a timeout. No goals for them in the first 10.5 minutes. England, on the other hand, has already put up 5, and it's a 5-0 lead for the English national team here. A bit of a surprising start for the United States. And we mentioned this is a very different team that played against North Carolina just 45 minutes to an hour ago. The U.S. putting in their second batch of players here, not a second team, but just a completely different batch of players. But it has to be tough maybe for the players on this squad because they sat there, watched their other teammates play, and now you have to get up and go for your own game as you mentally, maybe that's a bit of a challenge?
I would say to you that Coach Ricky Fried is not, these players don't make a lot of excuses for themselves. So I would certainly say he's not going to give them the opportunity to make excuses here. These are world-class players, and they have to be able to do those kinds of things. Likewise, England has sat around and waited for their game to occur as well. So I would say there's probably not a whole lot of positive vibes in that huddle right now. But again, just got to turn it around. It only takes one play to sort of spark this team, as we saw in a previous game. They can get as close as a goal and then blow up for 9 or 10. So, hope they make a change here. But I don't want to take anything away from the level of play that England has brought to this game. They seem to have no fear, just, taking great shots, moving the ball extremely well. And again, the key is getting the ball off the draw.
Well, coming up here at 6:30 p.m., we wrap up our day one coverage of the Team USA Fall Classic with a matchup between Canada and Australia. And don't forget, still four more games to go tomorrow here on LAC Sports Network. Those beginning at 9 a.m. and running throughout the afternoon. So a very, very busy weekend of games here at the new U.S. Lacrosse headquarters. This may be the most surprising part that we've seen so far, as England has fought to a early 5-0 lead about 11 minutes into this first half against the United States, and another draw control for the English side. England looking to add to this early lead. Good defense by the United States, and it's scooped up. Kaylee Waters almost lost it with some strong pressure there by England. Instead, the United States able to bring it over the midfield stripe. Here comes McCool racing into the offensive third of the field.
Good defensive play there.
Shot and a save. McCool couldn't get that one to go. And a save by Izzy McNabb.
Izzy McNabb had a tremendous game against Australia. She played the first half. She's had a great start to this game here.
A couple of early saves for her.
Unfortunately there, in the women's game, if you're outside of the goal circle, you can't re-enter the goal circle with the ball in your stick. You must put the ball in first. She didn't do that there, so you also get possession back.
And Maggie Bill. Excuse me, not Maggie Bill.
Allie Carey.
Allie Carey gets the United States on the board, 32 and 34. But either way, it's 5-1.
One of the things really like about Allie Carey, she started that defensive transition on the other end with a great defensive strip, makes her way up the field, hangs out in the offensive end, ends up getting a goal. Those players are very valuable, ones that can go both directions, play both ends of the field, and Allie Carey, a veteran to this team as well, certainly capable of doing that.
Carey, of course, part of that 2013 World Cup team that won gold just about 4 years ago now. Looking to make the team a second time around and be part of this U.S. squad for 2017 next summer across the pond in England. The U.S. looking to cut this roster down from 36 to 24, 25, Ricky Fried has said.
Yep. Looking at 24 after this weekend, then they'll cut down to 18 after the spring premiere down in Florida in January. Another great defensive play there by Allie Carey. She seems a little fired up to get her team back in this game.
Gets it to Alex Austin. She buries it low in the corner. Back-to-back goals for the United States. Cuts it back to a 5-2 game.
This is where the U.S. is extremely dangerous, when they're agitated
USA goal number 10,
and when they've had a little bit of a fire lit underneath of them. So I would, if I were England, I'd tread lightly here.
And this is really where the United States really seems to thrive, when they can showcase their athleticism and their depth and able to continuously run toward Ton Award winner and All-American off the bench.
Absolutely. I mean, it's to look at the bench now and see, a couple of different Towarton Award winners is got to be daunting for any team. But great play there by Allie Carey.
Lafferty and Carey at the draw control. And it's scooped up by the United States. That's Marie McCool. Double teamed. but she beats it along the sideline.
McCool's got tremendous speed. Made that turn there, made it look fairly easy.
Carey loses it for just a second, scoops it up. Now back over to McCool. Looks to create for herself. The U.S. has had trouble passing there in these tight quarters in this English defense.
England's definitely put a focus on making sure they clog up that middle a little bit. It's going to force the U.S. to go in and out, inside and outside, a little bit more quickly, maybe a couple skip passes added in here. Again, this is where they're so strong. England makes a great defensive play. They can't transition the ball out because of pressure. Now we're back on the offensive end.
Courtney Fortunato, a great hustle play there, the current Notre Dame player. And it's another offensive possession here for the United States.
Courtney Fortunato's last appearance internationally for the U.S. was with the U19 team in 2011. She played in the squad that traveled to Hanover, Germany. Superstar for the U19 team. Nice to see her make her presence known on the senior level.
That U.S. team won gold that year. The shot is off the post, as Carey will have no problem going over to collect it.
I would really like to see Courtney Fortunato get more involved on the offense. She made a great grab there. I'd like to see her take a couple shots. She's a great player.
That shot just wide, a backhand flip from Fortunato. A current senior at Notre Dame, part of an Irish squad that should be really strong this year with a lot coming back.
Yeah, I don't think the ACC is going to be short of teams that are strong. I think between ACC and the Big Ten, they're really the conferences that are churning out your national champions year after year, great teams.
Carey going near side, save there by McNabb.
Yeah, McNabb's a little too good for a shot that low angle. I'm sure Allie Carey wants to have it back.
Another chance, another save by McNabb, and England is getting a couple of really big saves there in goal to keep the U.S. off the board, but a turnover, an opportunity here for the U.S. Russell to Tumalo, and that pass is intercepted, but a whistle.
Yep, looks like we had a foul on the play just before the interception. Again, I talked about this earlier. One of the concerns with the U.S. team is their unselfishness. Sometimes they're trying to make too many passes where they need to let that fly. Tumalo has a rocket of a shot. Would have liked to see her just let it fly from where she was.
And so they set up the offense here for the United States. Carey, McCool in there. This is McCool. She hands off for Whitehurst. Francesca Whitehurst, current Georgetown player. She plays for Ricky Freed in her college career as well. She gets it to McCool, and she goes top shelf for the finish.
Whitehurst, another U19 player. She had just come off of a loss to Canada last summer. I think that's a little bit of a focus of the program, too, is to see where we can integrate U19 players into the senior team. You've got the Kayla Trainers who played on the 2011 team. So it's great for the program to see those players sort of start at that U19 level and move their way up.
And so that causes a timeout for England as the United States has scored three straight here. A run you're comfortable seeing here if you're the United States, 5-3. Your score about midway through, a little over midway through this opening half. And you mentioned the U19 team. This U.S. program is coming off a loss, something they're not used to in the world championship stage of things. And Canada is certainly gaining some momentum, taking from their first major international gold medal.
The last loss that the U.S. suffered at a U19 competition was 1995 in the inaugural event of U19 for the women. So definitely stings for the U.S. On the flip side, tremendous effort by Canada. They have some great talent. Again, they're seeing their talent move from U19 onto the senior team as well. It's great to have the competition. It's great to see some more parity come into the international game.
And you mentioned the youth. There are so many college players. We see Megan Whittle for this English side. There are a number of players currently for the United States who are still playing in college. It's something we're seeing across the board in this international game.
Yeah, and I think a real benefit in the United States is the is the advent of the UWLX for the women, an opportunity for them to continue to play after college at a very high level and against great competition. And I think that is showing in some of the players that you're seeing that maybe wouldn't otherwise have opportunities to play after college and really are responsible for their own training. Now you have this pro league that gives them another platform to train. And I think you're seeing the results here. Not only are you seeing the results for the U.S., but you're seeing it for other international teams as well who have players playing on those teams.
Absolutely. Well, a reminder, every day at 2 p.m. Eastern, Tilt and Flow brings you 4 hours of lacrosse talk. It includes interviews with the top newsmakers in the sport of lacrosse, along with insight and analysis you can't get anywhere else. Tilt and Flow on LAC Sports Network every day at 2 p.m. It's all LACcess. The guys there at Tilt and Flow had Hannah Nielsen on the show this week from Australia, obviously a former Tourton Award winner as well. And she was part of that Australian team scoring the game winner against England in the first game of the day here at the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic.
Hannah Nielsen, a bunch of years out of Northwestern, still playing at the very top of the game. She had great effort earlier today. So great for those young Australian players to have someone like that to look up to and to sit in a leadership position for them.
Kelly Rabel spins towards the middle, gets to Maggie Bill. The feed deflected, but the loose ball scooped up by the United States. It's Tumalo.
Tumalo doing a lot of work off the ball, something I'm sure Ricky Fried is happy about. In the past, she was really looking to be a scorer, which she still is, but now she's doing the other things well. She's feeding her teammates. She's coming up with ground balls. She's directing that offense.
Haas passed airmailed, and England collects. But another turnover gives it back to the United States.
Yeah, unfortunately, the England player there, I think that's Olivia Hump. She stepped offside there.
And so Maggie Bill brings it into the offensive third once again. Nice move, wide open, shot and a save. McNabb again standing tall in cage here for Team England. This is Megan Whittle, spins out of some traffic and some trouble in England, able to get it over the midfield stripe. And a chance here in an unsettled situation. Hop, shot and a score. To another top shelf finish, and it ends the 3-goal run for the United States.
If I could give that assist to McNabb, a great save there to start that play, certainly keeping her team ahead here. She's had 3 or 4 excellent saves just so far this half.
You goalies stick together on those points, right? How impressive is it for England? You get up 5-0, and how impressive is it for them to stop that 3-goal run and able to score and add to that lead once again?
Well, I think they needed it. You know, I think you certainly don't want to put the U.S. team on a run. You know, what they're doing is impressive. They're really frustrating the U.S. attack with that corner. They're really shutting off the pass in the middle, which is where the U.S. wants to look. So I think they're doing a good job. They're sticking to their game plan. They look very disciplined, and they look extremely fit.
England, one of the teams that's been here in the United States for a couple of days as they go in transition. A shot and a save. Waters kicks it out. And the backup, good hustle by the United States. And they will take it.
So one of the things that impresses me there about Kaylee Waters is, remember, she's not having the strongest half in the cage, but regardless, she's making effort where she can. She gets to that ground ball, she causes a turnover for her team, and we're going the other direction. So sometimes as a goalkeeper, everything might not be working the way you want in the cage. There are other things you can do to affect play. Merrifield took a decent spill there.
Little.
I don't think that felt very good.
No, it did not.
Yeah. Ooh.
Anytime you get a knee to the leg, that'll sting for a little bit. And a lot of trouble here for England. Nice spin move to get out of it. Lost over the end line. Good. And the United States will take it.
Good pressure by the U.S. there. I think they're starting to show their frustration as well. You know, wanting to possess the ball, knowing that they're making small mistakes, knowing they should be playing a lot better than they are. But they're doing what they can.
And so the United States takes over possession. Kaylee Waters gets it to her teammate Maggie Bill as they work it up the field here. Carr brings it into the attacking third. As Leonard goes to work, shot, another save by McNabb.
The U.S. is going to have to find a way to get some shots on McNabb straight on. They've been taking a number of low-angle shots.
Fortunato diving and finishing. Just as you said, they needed something in front. Courtney listened, and Courtney cuts it to a 6-4 game.
I think that may have been
Alyssa Murray, number 17.
Yeah. Again, that's going to be the key for them, to get the ball to the middle and take some high-angle shots. These lower-angle shots, McNabb's way too good for that, but get the ball to the middle of the eight, they're going to have success with that.
Kelly Rabel. Murray from Rabel.
She took a good shot there, too, at the end of that play.
Physical game so far between these two sides.
Yeah. Expect that physicality from the U.S. They're typically a physical team. Love to see the physicality from England.
And so the United States able to get back on the board, cut it to a two-goal deficit. Here with under 10 minutes to go in this opening half of the U.S. Fall Classic, game three.
Lara Zimmerman with a big draw control there.
And she just lost the ball.
Yep, lost the handle on that one. But again, look at her. She fights her way back. She gets the ball back. It's fouled by her teammate, but good hustle there by Zimmerman.
But England picks up possession. Megan Whittle just couldn't quite get that one, but collected by England. Claire Farrow tries to split the double team, eventually kicks it back over as they look to get back into the attacking side of this field here for England. Right down the middle, bounce shot, skips over the cage, and Waters his stick, but it's backed up by England. Floated to the top here. Lucy Lynch dodging, feeds in front, shot, and a save by Waters.
It's a good save by Waters. She had her feet in the right spot. Anticipated that ball was going to come back to the middle.
So now another opportunity here for the United States to cut this back to a one-goal deficit as Maggie Bill races towards the middle. Feeds over to Leonard. Now behind to Murray. And that is Fortunato. Back up top to Kelly Rabel. Her pass just a little wide, and England collects the loose ball.
Yeah, not the best pass there from Rabel. Good look into the middle. But again, I just think with as much as the U.S. defense is expending on the other end trying to get the ball back, the attack's got to be a little bit smarter.
And a shot and a score from Megan Whittle as she gets on the board. The current Maryland Terrapin extends that England lead once again.
Megan Whittle. Whittle's goal gives England a 7-4 lead, 7:51 to go in the half.
Nice catch by Whittle there to collect and go top shelf on Kaylee Waters, a player she certainly has to be familiar with over the years playing against North Carolina. They're not in the same conference anymore between Maryland and North Carolina, but they certainly play plenty.
Megan Whittle finally getting herself free.
Another draw control here collected by England. Pretty spin move by, I believe, Sophie Whitehead.
Pretty big swing by Alyssa Leonard. She's lucky she wasn't carded there.
Whitehead keeps possession here for England.
See Ricky Freed on the sideline imploring his defense to step out and cut off these adjacent passes.
Whittle draws the whistle, keeps possession as she was defended by Kristen Carr. Whittle going straight to the cage, shot is saved, kicked out.
Let's go, Fred.
So as you might see there, typically when the official raises a flag and the player takes a shot, the flag goes away. However, if the foul affects the ability for the shooter to take a good shot, they will award that shot again.
And that somehow scooted past Waters. Maybe some interesting spin coming off of Whittle's stick. Back-to-back goals for her, and it's 8-4 England.
I actually think this ball deflected off of number 25, McCool. We'll see if we can get a replay here, but I think Kaylee Waters was anticipating that to go in a different direction. It was deflected, I think, by McCool. Yep, hit the corner of her stick there.
Tough break.
That's unlucky there.
Really tough break for the United States. And it's been that kind of half for Kaylee Waters. So Allie Carey back at the draw control against Lafferty.
Yeah, you'll see it here, there. It just takes a deflection off of McCool's stick. She knows it right away. Stick on the ground, head down. That's a bummer.
No other way to put that one. Tough break for the United States as they look to maybe get it back here at the other end as Alyssa Leonard brings it into the attacking part of the field. Murray back up top. Fortunato loses it into the crease and it's collected.
Number of unforced errors here for the U.S. Can't make the coaching staff happy.
Another opportunity here for England. Waters way out of her cage. She gets back. And Hopp just decides to set up an offensive set here for England. Under 6 minutes to go in this opening half. Waters able to make a play, comes way out of her cage and loses it. So England, an opportunity, but Waters able to skirt back and retreat.
It's a great play by Kaylee Waters.
Out of bounds off the United States, England will keep possession. England looking to add to a 4-goal lead in the first half here.
I wouldn't be surprised to see England try to spread this out a little bit with a 4-goal lead, less than 5 minutes. I don't think they really want to press their luck too much. But if the U.S. is going to give them open goal opportunities, I'm sure they'll take them. But I wouldn't be surprised to see them try to slow it down some.
Shot goes wide. United States there for the backup, Sloane Serpy.
Yeah, and that's a mental error for England. Anytime you have the ball offensively, you have to make sure there's somebody behind the goal that can back it up.
So the shot really acts as a turnover. Yeah. She missed the open nets. And Carr will look to start something here for the United States.
Carr, one of the fastest defenders on the team.
A turnover there in the open field. Hopp in transition. Shot from way out is saved by Waters. And Carr able to collect and looks to now start something, and she draws the whistle.
I think Hopp had more time than she thought to take that shot.
Set up for the way out opportunity.
It's good to see from England, not afraid to take shots from wherever they are. They're certainly creating a lot of havoc for this U.S. squad.
Jennifer Russell brings it into the attacking third. Fortunato flips to Leonard. Shot in front for Aust. A little wide, but backed up by the United States.
Great look for Aust, just wide of the cage. Good back up there behind the goal with Fortunato.
So she starts from behind the cage. Out in front, Zimmerman shot, another save.
And again, you're looking at another low angle outside hand shot for a goalkeeper the caliber of McNabb, and the way she's played, that's just not going to cut it. She stepped in and out there.
And so that'll give it back to the U.S.
Yeah. So again, in the women's game, if the goalkeeper is straddling that line in and out, she is technically out. so she can't re-enter. That's just a mental error there for McNabb.
And a great opportunity for Alyssa Murray. She'll score all day long from that position. 8-5, back to a three-goal deficit for the U.S.
Team USA goal number 17, Alyssa Murray. Assist to number 15, Courtney Fortunato.
So McNabb raises her hand to her teammates. My bad there. I don't think she was really paying attention to where her feet were in that situation.
Essentially set up a penalty shot type situation there for the United States. We don't have the numbers in front of us, but England seems to have really done a good job at the draw control for most of this first half, and it's one of the reasons they have this three-goal lead.
I'd be surprised if the U.S. is leading in any statistical category right now. You know, England's kind of taking it to them all over the field, whether it's ground balls or caused turnovers, and certainly saves.
That draw control collected by the United States, an opportunity here. Zimmerman races towards the goal, sends behind. Murray in front, shot to score. It's Michelle Tumalo getting on the board, back to a two-goal deficit.
That's the kind of spark the U.S. team needed.
USA goal, number 35, Michelle
Great
Tumalo.
Defensive transition from Courtney Waite coming out of the defensive Tumalo end with Murray that draw, finding her teammate.
USA 6, 2:27 to go in the half.
And that's an easy shot. Tumalo's going to bury that 99% of the time.
Couple of Syracuse grads connecting for that one. Tumalo, one of the two players here for the United States that have played in both games here Saturday at this Fall Classic, coming off a goal and six assist performance against the defending national champions North Carolina in game two of the day here at the U.S. Lacrosse headquarters.
I think that's been very much of her focus, is to see where else she can contribute other than goals. You can tell she's worked very hard. You know, and it's showing for her today. Six assists is tremendous.
And you mentioned the UWLX influence on this international game. Tumalo and Murray, they both played together for the Philadelphia Force in the UWLX this summer.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's been a great resource for good players who are finished with their college careers, have an opportunity to keep playing at a high level. You know, and I hope it continues for many years to come in some capacity. I think these women deserve to have an opportunity to play as often as possible. I enjoyed watching it this summer. Rules were a little bit different. Games quick and fun.
We really had an opportunity to see the athleticism and the skill of some of these players.
Absolutely. We got a shooting space call here. It's a nice swing pass by Tumalo over to Laura Zimmerman. Laura Zimmerman is not known for her offensive prowess usually. She's a very consistent, steady player. She got absolutely leveled right there.
She feeds to Murray, and Murray finds some space inside the post. The United States back within one.
Oh, I give Zimmerman a lot of credit for getting up there, because she got absolutely leveled.
Goal for Team USA, number 17, Alyssa Murray.
Hard to see from that replay.
Pulls USA within one goal.
But she took a pretty good shot.
But the end result is a goal for the United States, so that always makes it feel a little bit better, right?
Yeah, she's a tough player and a hard worker. And pop right back up.
Murray's third goal of this game.
She gets an apology from the England player on the draw as well. That's nice to see. That's good sportsmanship there. She took a good shot.
It's certainly competitive, but a lot of these players have known each other or played against each other over the years.
Absolutely. They'll be fierce competitors on the field, but they certainly are good sports. You know, and when they get an opportunity, they'll apologize when needed.
Here comes Whittle racing, and his shot sails wide, backed up by England. And so England, an opportunity to try to get some of that lead back, but a turnover.
Yeah, unforced error there. I think Charlie Finnegan just took her eyes off the ball there. Sloane Serpy will restart here. And again, you got Cookie Carr coming out of the defensive end. She's like a freight train, so.
And the United States brings it into the attacking third. Nice catch there by Zimmerman. As Kelly Rabel hands off for Maggie Bill. Now to Leonard. Fakes to Rabel, shot and a save. And that will be a foul. Looks like it's on Leonard.
Yeah, once again, it looks like an attacking player's made contact with the defender with a stick afterward. They consider that an offensive foul.
But the United States gets it right back.
Again, even there, a little bit of impatience from Melissa Leonard, taking a shot out at the eight. That was pretty much an easy save for a goalie like McNabb.
Bill shot wide.
See if they can get a shot off here in the last few seconds.
8 seconds to go. Shot is easily collected there by England. And they will let the half run out. A half that started all England ends with the English national team with an 8-7 lead of the United States here at the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic, game 3 of 4 today. And the United States was able to come back from a 5-0 deficit, but still trails going into the half.
Well, if you're Phil Collier for England, you have a lot of good things to say at halftime. I know the U.S. made a comeback here, but overall, I think you got to be really impressed with the things that his squad has done so far in this half. You know, they're going to have to be a little bit careful. I think the conversation on the U.S. side is going to be probably a little bit heated. But good things from England in that first half.
And so as the teams meet at halftime, we will step aside here. Your score 8-7. We'll be back with some first half highlights and analysis here on LAC Sports Network.
Official partners, Rural by Guardian, MVP Visuals, Tissue Guard, and Sports Illustrated Flag.
The challenge is to come together and form a team, because a team isn't just a bunch of people that put on a jersey and look the same and wear the same outfit. Teams are able to challenge each other individually, not necessarily agree with everything that's done by you, us, but to get in line with what our goals are as a group. Everything you're doing for yourself is for something bigger than you right now.
If you haven't checked out Tilted Flow on LSN, you've missed one of the most talked about shows in the LAC Sports Network programming lineup, featuring some of the best interviews with the hottest names in lacrosse. Tilted Flow is your daily fill about what's happening now in the fastest growing sports today. And when we aren't talking about the sport, we're debating it. The good, the bad, and sometimes even the absurd. Tilted Flow on LSN. It's all LACsis.
Only on LAC Sports Network. Here's your chance to get the most unique second glance at the best MLL games from the 2016 season with RELAC. Inside Lacrosse's Kyle Devitt grabs some couch with Chris Marshall to bring you the ultimate LAC Rewind experience. Just kick back and RELAC as LSN drops the knowledge and humor you didn't even know you were missing. RELAC, only on LAC Sports Network. It's all LACsis.
Introducing LSN Academy, a unique opportunity for aspiring on-air reporters, gaining experience reporting live from college lacrosse games all across the country, developing on-air abilities, producing video reports featured on Lacrosse Now, and learning professional skills with access to feedback from the LSN team. Jumpstart your career in broadcasting with LSN Academy.
Welcome back to the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic presented by U.S. Lacrosse. Halftime of game 3 of 4 today. The U.S. trailing England 8-7 after 30 minutes. 10 minutes on the clock here at halftime. As we take a look at some of these first half highlights, Travis Eldridge and Melissa Coyne back with you. England jumped out to a 5-0 lead early, and it started with Laura Merrifield.
Absolutely, holding nothing back. England came out firing, and they didn't let up for quite some time.
And so England comes out firing, and it continued. Camilla Hayes with a couple of goals, including one from way out. And Kaylee Waters was having a really difficult time in net there for the United States early on.
Yeah, what I like to see from Kaylee Waters, though, is she may struggle making some saves, but she was trying to do some other things to help her team outside of the goal.
Plenty of hustle plays, but it didn't really matter for the U.S. as England started off really hot, but the United States able to start trickling its way back, as you see a great effort from Alyssa Murray there as they cut that lead back. But back came England, and one thing you saw was resiliency from England as Olivia Hump got on the board.
Yeah, I think the U.S. looked awfully sloppy in that first half. England had no problem capitalizing on that. I'd look to see the U.S. team clean that up a little bit. I'm sure that's what they're talking about. Defensively, and especially on their offensive end, you don't hold a team like the U.S. at bay very often. I don't expect that you'll see the same in the second half.
You also saw Megan Whittle for England get on the board there late in that first half, helping England lead 8-7 here at the break. Melissa, what types of things are you doing for the United States, especially on the offensive side? What types of things were they able to figure out when they made those runs to get back within one?
I think what they figured out is that the goalkeeper for England, McNabb, is not going to give up any low-angle shots. They're going to have to get to the center of the cage. They're going to have to create some big angles, get on top of her to get some high percentage shots. They were not doing that early in the first half. They struggled. She made some great saves. They started to do it a little bit towards the end of the second half. But again, I think they're really going to have to create high percentage shots to get it past McNabb.
And you see Coach Ricky Fried and Liz Robertshaw and company talking to this United States squad as they look to try to complete the comeback in this second half, trailing 8-7 at the break against England. We will be back with the second half here on LAC Sports Network. Game 3 of 4 here at the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic.
Why do we do what we do?
Well, we believe that participation in lacrosse positively influences lives.
We believe lacrosse should be open to all kids that want to play.
We believe in a future that offers everyone the opportunity to participate.
U.S. Lacrosse is a nonprofit organization that provides resources to fuel the sport's growth and development.
Support our efforts at uslacrosse.org.
Only on LAC Sports Network.
Hawks on 3, 1, 2, 3. Hawks.
An exclusive Major League Lacrosse presentation.
To the net.
Relive the journey to glory of the all-time greats as we take you into the huddle and onto the sideline during the 2005 MLL playoffs. A journey highlighted by the crowning of what many have called the greatest team to have ever played. MLL The Show, only on LSN. It's all LACcess.
Only on LAC Sports Network, Box Digest is your one-stop weekly home for everything surrounding the world of box lacrosse. We're talking Western Lacrosse Association, Major Series Lacrosse, National Lacrosse League, and more. Be sure to tune in every week as we bring you the very latest highlights and headlines from the best box lacrosse leagues on the planet. Box Digest, every Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. Eastern on LAC Sports Network. It's all LACcess.
Only LAC Sports Network. The Faceoff Academy with Greg Garillion takes an in-depth look at the faceoff position in today's game. The 2015 Major League Lacrosse MVP shows you how to develop your skills to become the best player you can be. From stance and wing play to shooting and lacrosse IQ, the beast has you covered. The Faceoff Academy with Greg Garillion on LSN. It's all LACcess.
Today's USA versus England game is presented by Under Armour. Under Armour, the official partner and equipment supplier of Team USA. Welcome back to the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic presented by U.S. Lacrosse. The United States trailing after 30 minutes of play. Trailing England 8-7 here at the new U.S. Lacrosse headquarters. Taking a look at some of these first half stats, the shots were in favor of the United States 21-17, but the saves were not, as England's goalie Izzy McNabb was terrific in goal. and the draw controls evened up by the end, but England had a good advantage there for most of that first half.
10 turnovers for the U.S. in the first half is a big number. I'm sure Ricky Fried talked to them about that at halftime. You know, ground balls, you rarely see a U.S. team get beat out on the ground. So I think it's just the little things that the U.S. team can do better in terms of the intangibles that could change this around a little bit. Credit to England for coming out fired up and ready to go with a clear game plan, especially defensively, to handle some of the U.S. firepower.
Taking a look at some of the scoring totals, Olivia Hump, Megan Whittle, Camilla Hayes, all with a couple of goals for England. For the United States, Alyssa Murray, the only multi-goal scorer. She had a hat trick in that opening half here for the U.S. as they were able to come back from a 5-0 deficit in that opening 30 minutes. Get it back to a one-goal deficit at the half. And we will see how the United States comes out after I'm sure there was a talking to by Coach Ricky Fried and company there on the sidelines.
Yeah, you know, at the end of the day, though, I think Ricky will be positive with them, try to settle them down a little bit, remind them to do the easy things well, and it'll make all the difference for Team USA. So let's look to see them come out with a little bit different attitude. I can see down there on the field now, Michelle Tumel has got a smile on her face. So I think although this is a competitive game, maybe not the way they anticipated it going, I think you'll see them sort of relax a little bit and settle into this game.
And Kaylee Waters is coming out for the second half, at least to start. We saw two different goalies in game one of the day for the United States. Kaylee Waters played the first half. She's at least starting here in the second half for the U.S.
Kaylee Waters is a good goalkeeper. She should be able to right the ship a little bit here from that first half. Again, she did some nice things outside the goal. Look for her to be a little bit more solid between the pipes in this half.
So Francisca Whitehurst collects the opening draw control, and she brings it into the attacking third for the United States. As Leonard sends it behind the cage to Ost. Back up to the top here. This is McCool. Shot in front is deflected before it gets to the cage, and it's collected by England. A desperation heave, but all red in the middle, and so England keeps possession.
Yeah, Allie Carey looked like she had a good look on cage, maybe held up a second too long.
And a great opportunity here for England. Sloane Serby, good defense there to keep England off the scoreboard. Sophie Merrill had a really good opportunity, at least when things started to work out. Racing to the front, shot to score. It's Lucy Lynch, gets on the board first here in the second half for England. And it's 9-7, back to a two-goal advantage for the English side.
Another nice offensive possession for England. Sophie Morrell did well to carry that in. She looked tempted by the seemingly open cage left by Kaylee Waters, but she showed good patience there. Again, getting to the middle of the eight, a high percentage place to take that shot from, able to put it by Kaylee Waters.
And so the United States continues to have to fight back here against England in game 3 of 4 today. The United States, their second game in back-to-back games here in this U.S. Fall Classic. The United States beating North Carolina 20-7 in game 2. That game going on about 1:30 start time here in Sparks, Maryland. But only two players carrying over from that game against North Carolina, as Alex Ost and Michelle Tumelo seeing double duty here this afternoon.
Nice work on the draw there by Jen Russell to box out her player. Jen Russell, another one of those longtime U.S. squad players, still maintaining a high level of play. She's a solid voice for the newer players.
And a turnover here for England. And you mentioned the turnovers at the half for the U.S., and it seems like some of those troubles have continued here, at least early on in this first half. Nice catch, shot to score. What a finish by Jenny Simpson. Spins in front, and it's back to a three-goal advantage for England.
Not much energy coming out of halftime for Team USA. The opposite can be said for England. They look excited. They look fired up. They look ready to play. The U.S. looks like they're just sort of reacting to what's happening out there, not really dictating play. Until they start to do that, it's going to continue to go the same direction.
Simpson's second goal of this game. And we saw England, a really good result. Couldn't quite beat Australia, but showed a lot of promise in that first game of the day, losing 12-11 in a heartbreaker against the Aussies in the first game of this Fall Classic. And it seems like that momentum may be carried over to this game.
Yeah, they did a lot of really nice things against Australia. They're doing some great things here against the U.S. I talked about it in the first game. A totally different culture here for Team England under some new leadership and with some new assistant coaches and a lot of new faces and new players. And it's great to see.
Russell Race is in the U.S. looking to get something going here in the second half. Still has not scored the first 2.5 minutes or so in this second half. Kelly Rabel feeds one in front, and Tumalo finishes.
That's an absolutely great look from Kelly Rabel. Skip passes is what is going to work against this defensive set. I think that's probably what she's saying to her teammate. Let's be patient, do what we know is going to work.
Michelle Tumalo with the assist, number 5, Kelly Rabel.
You got to have a lot of confidence to throw this pass across the 8. What a great look.
It's like when you watch a really good quarterback just kind of put the right amount of zip and float onto a pass, and that's exactly what Rabel did to find Tumalo for her second goal of the game, and it's back to a 10-8 England lead.
So the key here for the U.S. will be not to compound a great goal with a mistake. That's kind of been the theme so far in this game. They've had a great offensive play and then turned the ball over or let up an open cage goal, so let's see what they can do if they can string together a couple good possessions. Get a redraw here. Ball didn't go above their shoulders.
Draw control is even after the first half, and that trend has continued a little bit here in the second. Leonard able to go up and win that.
Now, Alyssa Leonard doesn't lose a whole lot of draw controls. Again, she used her body to box out Merrifield, who's bigger than she is, taller than she is.
The Northwestern grad able to get the United States another possession here. And here's Leonard, who jogs into the attacking third.
Alyssa Leonard made a career at Northwestern of being able to get the draw control.
Tumalo feeds it back to Leonard. But the pass back to Tumalo can't be completed, and another turnover for the United States. Sophie Whitehead collects, but an offensive foul.
And this is where Alara Zimmerman is valuable to Team USA. Again, not often shows up on the score sheet, but she does the little things well. She saw Merrifield kind of turn her head in one direction. She planted her feet and knew she'd be able to take the charge. It's a smart play by a veteran player.
So she gets a possession back for the United States. Maggie Bill looks to juke and race towards the goal. Instead, sends it back to Rabel. Here comes Zimmerman. Feeds behind. Lost by Leonard. She tries to box out and keep possession, and she does.
Does well to get it back there. A lot of bobbles from this U.S. team with the ball.
Rabel feeds in front. Leonard buries it.
It's a second great look from Kelly Rabel to a teammate. Great patience by Leonard. Again, high percentage shot from the middle of the 8.
And some of those passes were passes that Rabel did not make in the first half. You see, maybe she's collected herself a little bit here and been able to complete them here in the second.
Well, I'm guessing the coaching staff also was telling them where the openings are in this defense. I don't think they were seeing that on the field in the first half, but it seems they know exactly where they need to be looking now.
And so back-to-back goals here for the United States has cut that lead back to 1, now 10-9 after England had a 10-7 lead here in the second half, is led by as many as 5 goals. It was a 5-0 English lead. Now it's back down to just 1. The U.S., though, has not been able to get back over that hump and tie things up. We will see if they can do that here.
Yeah, Merrifield getting a little bit of a breather here, so that was Camilla Hayes on the draw.
Leonard, sky and forward again. She couldn't collect it. Loose ball, still loose, but England grabs it. Here comes Anderson. Splits the double team, but the pressure continues by the United States.
Yeah, there will be no backing off the defensive pressure here. The key is to see if the U.S. can get not only pressure on the ball, but shut off that next pass up top.
Lucy Lynch spins at the top, feeds in front. Good defense here by Sloane Serpy.
Yep. Again, you see Jen Russell working hard there, trying to shut off that adjacent pass, forcing England to put the ball behind.
Ball is loose as an England player slipped down.
Yep.
It was Higson who slipped, caused a U.S. player to trip, but the United States scoops up the loose ball, and here comes Maggie Bill.
It's the third or fourth player I've seen slide. I don't know if maybe they need a change in footwear or what, but it looks like they've slid a couple times.
A great feed from Bill, and the goal from Tumalo. The United States has tied it up at 10.
USA
this looks more like the U.S. squad we were thinking would show up here.
Maggie Bill. From Bill.
Again, just 10. Showing some patience and some discipline, especially on the offensive end. Working hard to shut those adjacent passes off on the defense. These are all things that are going to result in good things for the team.
The United States at its best when it's able to get out and run in transition. And that goal ties things up at 10 as Tumalo has a hat trick as well to go along with another former Syracuse player, Alyssa Murray, with a hat trick in the first half. The two of them combining for 6 of the 10 U.S. goals so far. Draw control way back into the U.S. end. As Sloane Serpy collects, gets it to Kaylee Waters. And an opportunity for the U.S. to take its first lead of this game.
Great job, Jen Russell, getting that ball up along the restraining line. I'm sure she'll dump it off and head back onside.
As Maggie Bill helps set up this offense with Tumalo. This is Courtney Fortunato, the current Notre Dame Fighting Irish. She gets it to Laura Zimmerman. Zimmerman has really been all over the field here today.
She really usually is. And again, what I'm impressed with by her is in the first half, you saw her kind of trying to take that low angle shot. Here she held it up, tried to work for a teammate with a better angle there. Seeing good things from the U.S. here in the second half.
Rabel shot wide, but it's backed up by the U.S. Here's Fortunato. Spins, feeds behind. Alex Ost. Now over to Maggie Bill. Bill jukes towards the middle and she scores. Maggie Bill gives the United States their first lead of this game at 11-10.
Another high percentage shot, center of the eight.
USA, number 34, Maggie
Bill. It's going to bode well from them going forward if they can keep getting themselves open in that spot. Yep, she's able to get her defender just a couple steps off, get her hands free.
The athleticism for Maggie Bill certainly showcased there. As we mentioned throughout that first half, not only does she play for the North Carolina Tar Heels lacrosse team, who is a national power, she also plays for the North Carolina women's soccer team as well, who is a team that is a perennial contender in the Atlantic Coast Conference. So the being on the U.S. national team, just another thing to add to her accomplishments. And she puts one home that gives the United States a lead here.
Incredible athlete, Maggie Bill. Glad to see her back on the lacrosse field. We have a goalkeeper change for Team England now in the goal, Lucy Grant. After a great performance from McNabb.
Yeah, she was terrific in that first half. Leonard back to Tumalo. Now Alex Ost as they work behind the cage. Loose ball collected there by Tumalo. She's got a hat trick here in this game for the United States. And she's playing her second game of this afternoon. One of the two U.S. players that played in both of these games, her and Alex Oss, both part of that U.S. win over the University of North Carolina earlier today.
Can't say enough good things about Tumalo. She has matured so much as a player from her days at Syracuse, where she was just a phenom, could shoot the ball from anywhere, could tend to be a little bit hot-headed sometimes, tended to lose her cool a little bit. Here you see her directing an offense, celebrating with her teammates, taking high-percentage shots, doing the little things well. She's matured tremendously.
And she's now teamed up with Katrina Dowd out there at Oregon, be part of that coaching staff for the Ducks, who they could put together a pretty good three-on-three team out there.
I don't know if you could come up with two better offensive coaches than Tumalo and Katrina Dowd.
Becca Block also out there as well, as we see a goal there in front for the United States. Alyssa Leonard makes it 12-10, and this is the U.S. team we probably expected to see at the beginning of the game.
Yeah, again, you know, I think it just takes them some time. Sometimes they had to really get away from thinking too much and trying to do too much, get back to the fundamentals, slow things down a little bit. Again, still a solid performance and effort from Team England. You might see a little fatigue start to come into play here. It is a lot to take on that constant pressure all the time. This is the period of the game where you tend to see the U.S. pull away a little bit. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see another U.S. goal for Phil Collier to take a timeout and kind of give his girls a little extra breather.
And when you talk to Ricky Freed, he said that's what they want to do. That's their strength. They have more All-Americans and Tour Todd Award winners than anybody else, any other national team. And so this is their opportunity to run players out, and that's one of the reasons why they like to split up these two teams into teams of 18 to simulate those 18-person rosters that they will see in the World Cup, get the substitution patterns and all those things in for next summer.
Yeah, I mean, Ricky and his coaching staff are incredibly deliberate in what they do. They're great planners. They have a plan in mind. They have a system in mind. Their expectation is that no matter what 12 they put on the field, that any of those 12 players will be able to execute what they're trying to do. And that's easier said than done. There are some players, there are tons of players within the U.S. system that, you know, just aren't quite ready to play within that system yet. The ones you see on the field are the ones that have bought into that.
The behind-the-back shot from Tumalo. She wanted goal number 4 on the day. Instead, it's deflected out. The U.S. keeps possession.
That's tremendous stick work there. But no big deal behind the back.
We saw Kylie Ohlmiller complete one of those, the current Stony Brook Seawolf in game 1 against North Carolina. She had a terrific game. 6 goals for her against the Tar Heels here for Team USA.
Nice to see the expansion, too, on the U.S. squad to some additional universities. Stony Brook putting a first-time player on there. A couple players from University of Virginia. It's just been really nice to see a couple of additional additions to that roster.
Lucy Grant able to collect that one in the cage and make the save there for England. Here comes Olivia Hump. Tries to spin out of some trouble, double teams.
Yeah.
And there's that U.S. pressure. England able to get out of it as Lucy Lynch goes to the corner. She flips it towards the middle, where it's collected there by Alyssa Murray. And so the U.S. with another possession here. Racing in. Tumalo feeds down in front. Scooped around.
Again,
good ball movement.
The patience, the control, the ball movement, all these things have improved from the first half. Like to see them put that away. The other thing hopefully they're paying attention to is that the Lucy Grant, the new goalkeeper for England, is left-handed.
A little bit of a change there for the United States.
A little bit of a change. They seem to be doing okay with it, though, so.
A nice run here for the U.S. to take this 2-goal lead. They did not lead until the second half as Alex Oss, the pretty catch and finish.
And again, Tumalo there with the assist.
An assist here for Michelle Tumalo, who also has 3 goals. She had 6 helpers against North Carolina earlier this afternoon. And Phil Collier wants a timeout for England.
Tumalo and England calls timeout.
So the U.S. has been able to stave off England here in the second half, trailed by three early in this half. But since then, a six-goal run for the United States to take a 13-10 lead.
Yeah, you definitely see some players within the England huddle here, bent over, struggling a little bit, maybe getting a little bit tired. It's a lot of pressure to take for such a long period of time. I think they've done tremendously well with it overall, but this may be the time of the game where it really starts to impact them. Second game of the day, smaller squad.
What has the United States been able to find? Because the English defense seems to have not changed too much in how much they've been packed in, but the U.S. seems to have been able to find more holes.
So where the U.S. in the first half was really trying to attack the center from the wings, they've now looked to attack that same center spot from behind. What that forces a zone defense to do is to turn defenders toward the ball from behind the cage. It puts their backs to where they would be open from the side. Now they have to turn their backs on the ball. It's a little bit tougher for the England defense to recover. It's requiring a lot more communication from their goalkeeper, and the U.S. seems to be having more success attacking from that spot.
Regardless of the outcome of this game, England has shown a lot so far in day one of this Fall Classic. They had a 5-0 lead against the United States. I mean, these two teams met some different rosters, but very similar type rosters this summer, and the United States dominated 20-2. What does this show us about England here this weekend?
They're improving. They're improving every time they get to train together. They're incredibly athletic. I talked about in the first game that they played, they've hired a strength and conditioning coach in James Wild, who has given them four-week chunk plans to take home and work on, and you can see that on the field. England historically have struggled with fitness. They haven't been the most fit athletic teams. This is a completely different culture for them and philosophy for them, and it's paying off.
It's been a really good day, despite not winning the first game, losing a heartbreaker 12-11 to Australia. Lots of promising things there, and of course the lead here early against the United States, currently a 3-goal deficit, but still plenty of time, just under 20 minutes to go in this game three of the day here at the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic. Of course, part of four games today and another four games tomorrow, as we will see the U.S. play against Canada and Australia tomorrow as well. England will have a chance to take on Canada tomorrow in game one. All of those games, of course, streamed here on LacSportsNetwork.com/FallClassic. And so the draw control collected by Serpy in the back for the United States. Floats it over to Alyssa Leonard. Here comes Leonard. Ball sent behind. Now back up top to Kelly Rabel. Her bounce shot floats wide, but it's backed up by the United States.
Not a bad shot to take there, sort of low angle, but she was smart enough to put it wide. Easy for a teammate to recover. Not sure, still don't like the low angle shots some of the U.S. team players seem to be taking, but in that case, it worked out.
Zimmerman goes low and picks up that pass.
Right, so again, trying to attack this zone from behind.
The hidden ball trick, and the shot in front goes for Alyssa Murray.
I think that was Tumalo again with the assist as well.
A couple of Cuse grads connecting for the highlight reel finish.
Faked out the camera there, I think, for a second.
The old fake flip with Alex Oss there behind the cage. And the English defense, not much they can do there. Great play by the U.S. to take a 4-goal lead.
But you see the low defenders there not being able to turn around to the ball and having to face the back, and that's a tough turn to make. The U.S. is taking advantage of it. I wouldn't be surprised maybe to see England change up their defensive strategy just a bit, get away from that zone a little bit to be able to play more of the center. They had great success in the first half shutting down that center. They're going to need to do it again.
Leonard goes up and gets that draw control once again, as we've got a whistle and U.S. will keep possession.
Yep, foul in the midfield coming down.
So Alex Oss will trigger things in. Sends it behind to Tumalo. That pass couldn't be completed. And a loose ball. Zimmerman once again. Great hustle play as she scoops it out to herself and she draws the whistle and the U.S. will keep possession.
One of the hardest workers on the U.S. squad. She and Jen Russell, who were teammates at North Carolina, just will get after any ground ball she can, will do whatever she can to keep that ball in the U.S. possession. She's invaluable to this team, trying very hard to make this 2017 squad.
A couple of the eight North Carolina players on this roster, either current or former Tar Heels. That's the most of any school, and it's fitting that North Carolina is also here as part of the Fall Classic as Kelly Rabel sends it wide. But the current Tar Heels not playing against their current team.
Correct. Good hustle here by the England player. From the camera angle, it may have appeared that the U.S. team player was ahead in that situation. But remember, it's whoever's closest when the ball actually crosses the line.
And so it'll be England that picks up the possession. Looking to end this seven-goal U.S. run in the second half. Led 10-7 in the second half, but has not scored in a handful of minutes. And halfway through the second half, they find themselves down by four, their largest deficit of the game. Kaylee Waters way out of the cage once again. She has been really aggressive, and it back to bite the United States as there's a score for England.
The expectation is for Waters to get out of the cage and play as an additional defender. There she was looking for her teammate, Mara Schwitter, to come up with that interception. Mara was just a step behind, and that's the result there when that happens. Everybody's got together in that ride.
And so Lafferty able to bury the shot in front.
Lafferty from Finnegan.
A veteran of the international team here for England, playing in the 2009 and 2013 World Cups, and she gets on the board here to make it 14-11. And that, of course, ends the U.S. scoring run of seven goals. The United States able to take control of this game after not leading in the first half, but the U.S. much more comfortable now by three at 14-11. As we go back to the draw control.
Nice draw control there by Allie Carey in a lot of traffic, keeping her head down, coming up with that ball.
The U.S. Fortunato brings it in, Courtney Fortunato. Tumalo once again working from behind the cage. Now it's Carey. Here's Marie McCool, races in front and scores.
McCool had the England defense confused there for a minute. No one was quite sure who was supposed to pick her up. And when no one picks her up, that's the kind of stuff that happens. So great patience by her to kind of let England settle in and then take another step toward the goal.
Haven't called her name much here in the second half, but the current North Carolina Tar Heel gets on the board to make it a four-goal advantage once again at 15-11. Tumalo, like Bill, just a really good athlete coming out of North Carolina, and you can see your speed there.
Yeah, I think that's another thing that, again, the coaching staff is looking for is just athleticism. This roster, top to bottom, all 40 players are just great athletes. And having talked to Phil Collier, that's a model he's looking to employ with England.
And then you see an athlete like a Megan Whittle on England at current Maryland Terrapin. Certainly the influx of talent there. Wide open shot is just wide for Camilla Hayes, but England there to back it up and keep possession.
Yeah, the U.S. got lucky there. Olympic was looking to tip that ball and the goal just missed tipping it wide. Again, just relentless pressure from this defense.
And it's scooped up there by Kristen Carr. And she keeps possession U.S. Transition opportunity here for Whitehurst. Sent it to McCool. Tumlo couldn't quite get the behind-the-back finish to go.
Yeah, she paid the price a little bit too there. Taking a good shot. She gets herself back together though.
And she sits there behind the cage as the offensive set continues here for the U.S. McCool floats it back to Alyssa Murray. Now to Tumalo. As the U.S. now a four-goal advantage. Remember, the international game, unlike the NCAA, now implementing no shot clock. The U.S. pretty content to take their time and get a good offensive.
Yeah, the FIL, Federation of International Lacrosse, writes their rules every 4 years. So we're on a little bit of a different rules cycle than the U.S. NCAA or U.S. lacrosse. So it'll be interesting to see what they do. 2017 is a rule change year for them. It'll be interesting to see what they do, what changes they may try to update in the women's.
Would you expect things to possibly change as the NCAA changes things? As McCool goes top shelf for the finish.
No, I don't know. I think the FIL has done their best to sort of stick to the traditions of the game. Change has not been plentiful, but I think there are some they could do to make the game just a little more exciting, take away some of the restrictions. But I also wouldn't be surprised for them to stick with exactly what they have.
As the North Carolina player makes it 16-11, 12 minutes to go in this second half of game three today at the Classic. A couple of goals here for McCool in the second half.
I do think that now that more countries have players coming to play in the U.S., more players going to play in Australia where they use free movement and some of the other things that you've seen, I think there will be more pressure on the FIL women's rule to make some of those changes.
You see the game continuing to speed and evolve as a shot just missed.
Fortunato, actually, I think she was looking to hit Alex Ost on the corner with a behind-the-back pass. Good to see them maintaining some creativity, even a little bit of a stressful game for them.
As we've mentioned, these rosters will be cut down to 24 for the United States after this week. So this game and then two more to go tomorrow for these players to show their stuff and try to make that roster of 24 before they eventually trim it down to 18 for the World Cup next summer.
I think it's a tough task, is putting it lightly, to come up with 16 players from this weekend who won't move on to Florida in January.
Really, talent across the board, current and former All-Americans, Tuwartana Award winners. All these players have been terrific in their own individual careers.
It's a good problem to have.
Certainly, yes. One that many other countries would love to have.
Yeah, but you're also seeing players who are eligible to play for the U.S., whether that's Hump or whether that's Whittle, could play for the U.S. as well, getting opportunities with other countries.
Yes, and you mentioned Whittle. Her mom was born in England. That is her connection to the country. One of the reasons she can play for Team England is there's a goal there by Whitehurst. Current Georgetown Ahoya, who plays for Ricky Freed in the college season, gets on the board. The U.S. in control, up 17-11.
Yeah, the Federation rules on playing for other countries is fairly lax. You know,
yeah.
They want to create an opportunity for players from all countries to play wherever they can. I think right now that works to give those opportunities. I think once lacrosse gets higher up in the Olympic conversation, then you'll really see sort of those restrictions come more into play about who can play where. But in the game, it's great for a Megan Whittle. It's great for an Olivia Hump to have an opportunity to play for other countries.
Yeah, Whittle with a really interesting story. Her grandfather, it was a story that was in Lacrosse Magazine this week about her. Her grandfather worked for the NSA and was stationed in England. And that's where her mother was born. And is why she is eligible to play for this English squad. She suited up for the England team against this U.S. team this past summer in that 20-2 loss over across the pond where they will play the World Cup in 2017. She scored a goal in that game, and she's got a couple here today.
Yeah, I mean, you're teams as well. You've got a number of U.S. citizens playing for Israel, you know, playing for Scotland, playing for Wales or the Netherlands. So it's great. It's a great opportunity for these players, and certainly international lacrosse is a very special experience, and glad to see lots of players have that opportunity.
Nice save there by Lucy Grant.
Again, I hate to pick on it, but that's the second or third shot I've seen Kelly Rabel take that's, you know, just not, probably not what Ricky Fried wants to see. Lower end shot, not a tough save for the goalkeeper.
And so we've got a whistle and...
Yeah, goal circle on the U.S., so the England goalie get this ball in the circle. Can't follow through and make contact with the goalie outside of there.
And you mentioned that the American players who are playing for other countries, we saw it in the U19 for the men's as well this past summer, where you have two and three All-Americans playing for an Israel or other countries throughout the world.
It's only going to improve those squads, make them more competitive. Again, nobody wants to watch a cup that's a complete blowout. So the more parity that we have, the more exciting the sport is, the more people want to watch it. And when you're talking about Olympics in the future, you've got to create a exciting to watch and build excitement for an event.
And so the U.S., it's been an exciting second half for them as they have dug out of that early 5-0 hole and in control. Now the bounce shot goes for Murray. Another goal for her. It's been a really good game for Alyssa Murray. The former Cuse star makes it 18-11.
Syracuse, another school well represented on this U.S. squad. Missing Kayla Traynor from the mix this weekend, recovering from an injury.
Yep. I think it's interesting.
You add her into this mix.
And it's just, it only makes things even more difficult to defend. I think it's really interesting. You look at how many North Carolina Tar Heels, traditionally, a lot of them are in the defensive side or the midfield. And then Syracuse with Gary Gade, and known for their offensive prowess, you have a lot of them. Unit, you kind of see the mentality of those teams reflected in where those players end up on the national team.
Certainly. Syracuse is stacked with offensive talent. Not surprising, giving their head coach is likely the best offensive player of all time.
And I think talk to Kayla Traynor or any of these players about Gary Gade, and that is how the team kind of practices. They learn the behind-the-back finishes and the creative. They have a lot of fun doing it, and they have certainly been successful under Gary Gates so far in his tenure.
There are plenty of plenty of players all over the country in coaching capacities everywhere that have been touched by Gary Gates' expertise and talent. Look no farther than Jen Adams, who Gary brought into the University of Maryland from Australia. She obviously did the majority of the work, but his confidence in her, what he taught her, made her the he turned out to be, and that can be said for a lot of players. So great contributions he's made to the game, to the women's game, to the men's game. I can't think of anyone that's maybe had a greater impact on the sport of lacrosse across both games than he has.
And Jen Adams went on to really help that Australian national team, of course coached by her sister Trish here at Classic this weekend.
Yeah, I spoke earlier about Trish Adams. I played against Trish Adams in the 95 U19 championship. She was tremendous player in her own right, and had a tremendous international career.
As a shot to finish for Higson, puts England back on the board at 18-12.
And it looks like we've got Rachel Vanderkolk in the cold, U.S.
out of the University of Virginia. One of those younger players on this team, a 2018. It makes you feel old, right?
Yeah.
As she has been really good for the University of the ACC Freshman of the Year back in 2015.
Yeah, really solid goalkeeper. I think she's got a great career in front of her. She obviously has great resources down there at Virginia. I'm glad she's in the mix here. This is a good experience for her to have. I don't, you know, I think she's got a little ways to go before she would make that final squad. Nice to see her here and to get this experience and to know that she can compete at this level.
One of three really younger goalies, current college players. Next here for Team USA is Gussie Johns from USC and, of course, Kaylee Waters, who we saw for most of this game coming out of North Carolina. And really interesting with Gussie Johns playing for Devin Wills at USC. She certainly has plenty of coaching going on out there.
Well, you know, everybody wants to see Devin Wills on the field. I know she's recovering also from an off-season injury, but it's giving us an opportunity what the future of U.S. team goalkeeping could be. And I think that's a good thing for the program.
As a transition goal for England, makes it 18-13.
Yeah, I really like what we're seeing today from England. No quit in them. In the past, you might have seen them say, oh, we're tired, we've done well. We scored 10 goals, we can pack. There is no quit in this team. And again, just a real positive change in culture for them.
Torres Anderson, one of those younger players, continuing to be fed into this England system, a 2011 U19 World Cup participant. And what has I was speaking to some of the players, including Data Doby from Team Canada, this week about bringing these college players in, and she was saying how it really continues to build the level of the game because these college players are year-round with their team, so it's not new for them to come and play three games in a weekend. Have you seen that really continue to pump up the level of play?
Absolutely. You know, the game has changed so much. It really has become a year-round sport. I think at this level, at the college level, at the international level, that can be a bonus. We don't like to see it as much at the youth level because we really want to see kids, younger kids, focusing on multi-sports.
Right.
Not a big fan of sport specialization for the youth. But at this level, the more opportunities these women have to play together, the better these teams are going to be.
As the U.S. sets up shop on the left side of Bill Tierney Field here at the U.S. Lacrosse headquarters. The loose ball collected by Lucy Grant in cage for England.
Yeah, unforced turnover there for the U.S.
It's been a cleaner second half for the United States after, I believe, 10 turnovers in that opening 30 minutes.
Again, that's exactly the defensive pressure that Ricky Freed wants to see on the backside of that defense.
It's Maggie Bill scooped up the loose ball, draws the whistle, and floats it ahead to Alyssa Murray, who has had a really good game here for the United States.
For sure.
Talk about the offensive players in this game. And Kylie Ohlmiller, 6 goals in game 1 against North Carolina out of Stony Brook. Really a big game for her. On this stage, Alyssa Murray and Michelle Tumalo both with really good games here in game 2.
Yeah, impressive to see Ohlmiller in that first game. She's quite a player, had a great year for Stony Brook. Expect that she'll continue to.
As Alex Ost darts into the middle and finishes once again. She had 3 goals and 2 assists against North Carolina, and she has continued to add in a couple of more here in game 2.
Goal for Team USA, number 10, Alex Ost. Assist, number 23.
And this has really been the recipe for success for the United States in the second half.
Teammates working well together. Allie Carey set a nice off-ball pick there for Alex Ost, who's able to get around, get herself free. High percentage shot, not much that Lucy Grant can do about that.
So under 5 minutes to go in game 3 of the day here at the Fall Classic. The United States back in control, but this game has really been back and forth. If you're just joining us, 5-0 England led. The U.S. did not lead until the second half as a big collision.
Yeah, I think Cookie Carr is going to get rung up here for a yellow card. She came in with a cross check there, a little uncontrolled. Glad everybody got up all right there.
Yeah, first card of this game.
Yeah. non-releasable at the international level. Yep, just came in there a little under control, had good intentions, just didn't work out.
So England, the good opportunity. See Charlie Finnegan collected in the offensive zone for England.
Charlie Finnegan's had a good day. She had a good day against Australia. She's a solid ball handler.
If you're a fan of the college game, you likely remember her from the University of Virginia. The United States still maintaining a lot of pressure here on England.
Nice defense in the middle there by Mara Schwitter. She's closed that gap a little bit, struggled trying to close the defensive gap in the first half. Looks like she's corrected that here.
Shot sails wide. Lafferty couldn't quite get that on frame, but it's backed up by England.
I think she'd had just about enough of Allie Carey and wanted to get rid of that ball there.
Really strong defense here from the United States. As we tick towards 3 minutes to go in this game. Remember, we still got one more game to go here in the Fall Classic from Sparks, Maryland. Canada and Australia, the Canadians' first game of this Fall Classic coming up at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Finnegan tried to weave her way through, lost it, but she draws a whistle. It'll be a free possession opportunity here for Finnegan in England.
Yeah, Sloane Surpee not happy that she committed this foul. A center hash 8 meter, not where we want to be. Good
Finnegan
save,
goes low, but the save there from Vander Kolk. Her first real action of this game. As she came in the United States spent a lot of time on the offensive end ever since Kaylee Waters left.
I don't think you'll hear a goalie complain much about the ball being in the offensive end, but good concentration by her. The ball's on the other end a lot. When she's called on to do it, she does, so that's a good sign.
And this is to another goal from Alyssa Leonard. United States really comfortable here. 20-13 your score with about 2 minutes to go.
Yeah, and I know you see England on the sideline maybe scratching their head a little bit, like how did this all of a sudden happen and get out of control? But this is the result of 60 minutes worth of pressure. And it forces teams to take chances and make mistakes. It exhausts teams on both ends, and this is the result.
And you've spoken about how the U.S. made some adjustments on offense as well. They really, the recipe for success here in the second half has been working a player behind the cage and having players flash towards the middle, and it has worked out really well for the United States in this second half, able to come back and gain control of this one. Just a couple more minutes to go for a long afternoon here for the United States. They played University of North Carolina at 1:30. This is the second of two games here today for the U.S. They also play two more games tomorrow that you can see here on LAC Sports Network as they take on Canada and Australia at 2 p.m. and 4 p.m. to wrap up this Fall Classic. Both those games will be very interesting considering Canada is coming off that U19 gold medal back in 2015 last summer, so plenty of momentum for them. A lot of those players are on that team as well.
Not only the players, Scott Teeter being elevated to the head coach of the Canadian national team, well-earned given his success with the U19. You saw a similar thing happen on the Australian side with Trish Adams moving from U19 coach then to the head of the senior team. Canada has to be coming in here with an awful lot of confidence. Haven't had a chance yet to speak to Scott, hoping to do so before the start of the next game, but I would imagine that they're coming in here with really nothing to lose except for to showcase what they've been doing well lately, which is taking young players, making them unafraid to take risks, and the results have been very good for them.
Teeter, of course, the head coach at Canisius, where he has been for quite a while, and he has a midfielder in Erica Evans. That was Canisius' first ever All-American this past season, and we will see her up next here as Canada takes on Australia. And she is one of a handful, a number of players that were on that U19 team who currently play in college.
Serena Lasoto, who I think is maybe the most underrated player in the game right now. Incredible stick skills, tough and gritty. I think she makes a big impact for that team.
So time ticks down here. 30 seconds left to go for the United States. They struggled early, down 5-0, did not lead in the first half. But this group of players for the U.S. able to find a way and really dominate the final 25 minutes or so here against England. And they will come away with a 20-13 win over England. Plenty to be happy about if you're the English squad and head coach Phil Collier, but the United States gets the win they expected. A 7-goal advantage for the U.S. as they go 2-0 here in day one of the Fall Classic. What will be your one big takeaway from this afternoon?
If I'm the U.S., I understand that we've got to do the easy things well. As high a pressure as we play, we got to be patient, let that sink in, let it work, and do what we do best. If I'm England, I take nothing but positives from this game. They came out with tremendous firepower. They were not afraid. It's the best England squad I've seen in a while. Certainly no reason to hang their heads.
And so England goes 0-2 in day one. Still one more game for them to go on Sunday. Tomorrow they take on Canada in the first game of the day. So 0-2, but plenty of positives to take away. As for the U.S., they've got two more tomorrow as well. We're going to step aside here on LAC Sports Network. When we come back, we'll recap this one, hopefully chat with a couple of the stars of this game here at the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic presented by U.S. Lacrosse. We'll be right back.
If you'd like to check out the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame Museum, we'll remain open until the start of the fourth game.
Today's Canada versus Australia game is presented by Nationwide.
Why do we do what we do?
Well, we believe that participation in lacrosse positively influences lives.
We believe lacrosse should be open to all kids that want to play.
We believe in a future that offers everyone the opportunity to participate.
U.S. Lacrosse is a nonprofit organization that provides resources to fuel the sport's growth and development.
Support our efforts at uslacrosse.org.
Only on LAC Sports Network.
Hawks on three, 1, 2, 3. Hawks.
An exclusive Major League Lacrosse presentation.
Here's Powell to the net. He scores!
Relive the journey to glory of the all-time greats as we take you into the huddle and onto the sideline during the 2005 MLL playoffs. A journey highlighted by the crowning of what many have called the greatest team to have ever played. MLL The Show, only on LSN. It's all LACcess.
Only on LAC Sports Network, Box Digest is your one-stop weekly home for everything surrounding the world of box lacrosse. We're talking Western Lacrosse Association, Major Series Lacrosse, National Lacrosse League, and more. Be sure to tune in every week as we bring you the very latest highlights and headlines from the best box lacrosse leagues on the planet. Box Digest, every Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. Eastern on LAC Sports Network. It's all LACcess.
Only LAC Sports Network. The Faceoff Academy with Greg Garillion takes an in-depth look at the faceoff position in today's game. The 2015 Major League Lacrosse MVP shows you how to develop your skills to become the best player you can be. From stance and wing play to shooting and lacrosse IQ, the beast has you covered. The Faceoff Academy with Greg Garillion on LSN. It's all LACcess.
Welcome back here to the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic presented by U.S. Lacrosse here on LAC Sports Network. Travis Eldridge and Melissa Coyne back with you to recap this U.S. win over England 20-13, your final. The U.S. struggled early, but able to really clean things up in the second half and come away with a win. The U.S. going 2-0 in day one at the Fall Classic, also beating the University of North Carolina in the second game of the day, winning 20-7. Melissa, as we wait to talk with Coach Freed and company here for the U.S., what players maybe stood out here as we in this game too, as we had a chance to see a new crop of players that could be in that mix of 24 that survived this weekend?
Alyssa Leonard certainly stood out for me. She just was sort of all over the field doing good things on both ends, scoring a bunch of goals. Michelle Tumalo, who has been in the mix for a little while, but again, she's really evolved as a full, you know, whole complete player. Really impressed by what she did. I thought that Gussie Johns, looked good here. Kaylee Waters, she struggled a little bit. The goalkeeping overall today for the U.S., I would say, has been mostly solid. I think they did some good things. I think what I like the best about this second squad here was that things were not going their way, not playing well, but able to make changes, able to sort of right the ship midstream. And that's really important when you go to a World Cup. Not everything's going to go your way. You're going to have games where you have challenges. And I like to see sort of the resolve of this team when they didn't have their best to still be able to come out and perform.
Yeah, they really dominated the final 25 minutes or so. England took a 10-7 lead there early on in the second half. The U.S. responding with seven straight goals. That really changed the complexion of this game as the USA was able to grab control and keep it and go on for the 20-13 win. So the U.S., of course, will play two more games tomorrow as part of this U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic here at the new headquarters in Sparks, Maryland, as they get Australia and Canada tomorrow. But for right now, we are joined by the head coach of Team USA, Ricky Fried. Coach, obviously not the start you wanted. What did you find out about your team here today?
On the downside, on the positive side, England came out really strong, really took it to us athletically. And we started to react negatively and tried to do too much, I think, at times. And that's what we talked about at halftime. Second half, we did an exceptional job of playing our style of lacrosse and playing together. So that was the biggest piece, overcoming that hurdle and making sure that we moved forward.
Ricky, offensively in the first half, it looked like you guys struggled with not as much open space in the middle as you would have liked, looking to try to force that ball in the middle. It seems you changed your point of attack a little bit in the second half. Can you talk about some adjustments you made?
Yeah, the biggest thing was just making sure we were maintaining our spacing. We were starting to congest the middle because individually we thought we were open, so we followed cuts. And in a sense, that's exactly what they wanted us to do. And we made poor decisions with the ball by forcing it inside. So second half, really, we just talked about spacing, making decisions, know what we're going to do next, as opposed to hesitating, overthinking things.
Coach, obviously no team wants to be down and in the position you were and struggling like you were, but are there positives that you take away knowing that you were in that position and you were able to overcome that and gain control like you did in the second half?
Yeah, obviously in retrospect, there's a lot of positives to take from that. In the moment, not thinking about the positives in that moment, we weren't thinking about the positives so much. But yeah, there's definitely things that we can take from us, and it's a lot better to be in this position now than it is next July.
Well, certainly experience you guys can learn from. Congratulations on the two wins. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks so much.
Head coach Ricky Fried of Team USA talking about this win for the U.S. And we are also joined by Alyssa Murray, who had a terrific game here in Game 2. Alyssa, talk to us about what types of changes you guys were making at halftime and what coach told you when you're trailing England, a position you probably didn't expect to be in.
Yeah, I mean, definitely not a position that we are familiar with usually and want to be in, but we just really focused on staying with our system, trusting the system, and really not trying to get individual is the main thing that they talked about. And just as soon as we start to play together, that's when things all come together across the board. And once we really did that, things really just started to pick up, and across the field, our confidence went up.
Alyssa, you shared a field today, a good portion of the game, with a teammate in Michelle Tumalo. She seems to have really evolved as a complete player, looking more to feed. What's it like to be on the field with her? What kind of leader has she turned into?
Oh, I mean, she's a great leader, and that's something that I think that we were able to connect in Syracuse with, is just having really great chemistry and being able to bring it to the national level is awesome, and she's able to connect and do all that with all of our attackers, and it's really awesome to see. It really helps gel the offense.
How much fun is it to play with her, not only at Syracuse, but here and also in the UWLX?
It's awesome. We have a great time playing together, and, you know, we're really good friends. So it's just another time that we get to see each other and hang out.
Well, congratulations on the win. Enjoy this one. We'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you.
That is Alyssa Murray joining us here at the U.S. Lacrosse Fall Classic, and that puts a wrap on Game 3 of the day. The U.S. taking down England 20-13. We will be back with Game 4 of the day between Canada and Australia. But for now, for Melissa Coyne, I am Travis Eldridge. Thanks for watching the Team USA Fall Classic presented by U.S. Lacrosse. We'll be back at 6:30 p.m. for that game between Canada and Australia.